Dear students, in this video, we will be discussing about pistil. Pistil. It is otherwise called as gynecium. Both pistil and gynecium, both are same. Okay. First of all, where it is located? What is the function? That we have to understand. In the first video, we have seen a typical angiospermic flower. In that we have four whorls, right? The first whorl is calyx, the second whorl is corolla, third whorl is andrecium, the fourth whorl is gynecium or pistil. We know that it is first whorl, it is second whorl, calyx, corolla, these two together called as non-essential whorls or organs of the flower. These inner two whorls are the third whorl, that is andrecium. This one is gynecium. Total we have four whorls. It is andrecium, third whorl, which is already discussed in the previous lectures. Okay, it is all about male reproductive structures. The innermost, the fourth whorl, is gynecium, which is female reproductive structure. Okay, up to pollen grain and gamete formation, we have discussed about andrecium. Okay, now we have gametes. Actually, we have gametes. Now, in this video, we will be discussing about gynecium. Okay, means female reproductive organs. Okay, now we will see the structure of typical angiospermic pistil. Okay, the pistil, which is innermost whorl in the flower, consists three parts. Three parts. The apical tip is called stigma. This elongated tube-like structure is called style. The basal swollen structure is called ovary. A typical angiospermic pistil consists three parts: stigma, style, ovary. Okay. The function of stigma is, it is a receiver for the pollen grains. Means here we have pollen grains released from anther. Okay, that pollen grains will fall on different surfaces. Okay, but they do not germinate. Whenever the pollen reach this surface, they started to germinate, because stigma secrete some nutritive materials for the growth of or germination of pollen grains. By using that secreted material, pollen grains which were fallen on the stigma surface, they absorb those materials and they started to germinate. Okay, that is a function of stigma. It is first capture the pollen grain, after that it will allow to germination of pollen grains. Okay, it is also having some specificity, means the secreted materials only useful for the specific, means required pollen grains or wanted pollen grains only. Okay, that is a one more characteristic feature of stigma. The structure of stigma vary, diversified, means for example, the stigma may be a needle tip like this, sometimes a needle head like, means like this. Sometimes stigma is shallowly lobed like this, sometimes completely flat, sometimes deeply lobed, sometimes tongue like or sometimes plumose or broom like. Usually in grasses we can see these type of stigmas. Okay, Because grasses are mostly wind pollinated plants. That's why to catch the pollen grains, the stigma is modified into brooms or plumose type. Okay, usually plumose type of stigmas are found in grasses. This is structural diversity of stigma. Function also, we know the secretion of nutritive material for the germination of pollen grain. There is a function of stigma. Usually stigma surface is sticky, which is useful to trap or to catch the pollen grain from wind. Okay, next part is style. Style, it is a tube-like or a rod-like or a filamentous-like structure, elongated structure. It is located between stigma and ovary. Okay, the main function of style is it is useful to place the stigma at different heights. Means each plant having some characteristic feature. Means, for example, some styles are 1 centimeter, some styles are 2 centimeters, like that. Characteristic features every flower should have. Okay, based on that genetic makeup, the length of style will be differ from one plant to another plant. It is useful to place the stigma at different height. Okay, whenever it help to place the stigma at different heights, it is useful or it facilitate the probability of catching pollen grains. That is a one function what the style do. Okay, another function is it also avoid pollen contamination. Okay, for example, here it is essential pollen grain, means suitable pollen grain. Okay, in the air there will be n number of different types of pollen grains. Okay, these are the unwanted pollen grains. Based on these secretions, only the eligible pollen grains only germinate usually. Others are not able to germinate on stigma surface. Okay, but sometimes some other pollen grains, like for example, belongs to same family, that pollen grains also can able to germinate on the stigma surface, but it is not a suitable pollen grain. That's why again the style do one more function, that is due to the length of the style, only this length is very comfortable or very suitable for the eligible pollen grain only. For example, this pollen grain germinate and the tube form up to 2 centimeters long. Okay, this is 2 centimeter long. Okay, the other pollen grains may be produced up to 1 centimeter or 1.5 hardly. Okay, what happening here? Many pollens are germinating on the stigma surface, but due to this characteristic length, they are disqualifying or they are filtering here in this. That's why it is called buffer zone. It is act as a buffer zone. Due to this long stigma length or characteristic length, they are unable to reach the ovules. That's why the unwanted pollination or unwanted fertilization is filtered here itself. That is the main function of style. Okay, only the eligible or suitable pollen grains only successfully they develop pollen tube up to 2 centimeters and finally they reach destination, that is ovule. That is a function of style. Okay, styles are usually two types. The first one is some styles hollow in anatomy. Means whenever we open the style, some styles are hollow, means tube like there will be small pore or gap in the style. Some styles are solid, means they are filled with parenchyma tissue. Okay, like this. For example, if we cut the hollow style, the style having a tube like structure inside, this is hollow style. The solid styles totally filled with filling tissue or parenchymatous tissue. But both in this type and in this type also pollen tube will be move, no problem. But it is only types, two different types. It is very convenient when compared with this solid type. Okay, next, Coming to the ovary, it is very important part, which is basal part, swollen structure. It consists ovules, either one or two or many. Okay, based on the species, the ovules numbers are different. Okay, usually the ovary, a basal swollen structure, consists ovules. Okay, they are attached, the ovules are attached in the lower surface of ovary with the help of a stalk like structure called funicle. With the help of funicle, the ovules are attached on the lower surface of ovary. Okay, one more thing, the ovule where they are attaching, that place is called placenta. Very important, placenta. At the placenta, the ovules are attached to the lower surface with the help of a structure, a stalk like structure called funicle. Okay, we will discuss more about ovule in the next video. Now we will see the arrangement only. Okay, now based on the location of these placenta, we have different types of placentations in angiosperms. Okay, now we will see one by one with the transfer section so that we can easily understand. There are usually 4-5 types. Number one is marginal placentation. Number two is basal placentation. Three is parietal placentation. Number four is free central placentation. Number five is axial placentation. Number six is even apical placentation, also rarely found in the angiosperm ovaries. Okay, now I will draw simple diagrams so that we can easily understand. Okay, for marginal placentation and basal placentation and apical placentation, we will observe with the longitudinal section of ovary. Okay, with the longitudinal section, we can easily understand these three things. Okay, first we will see marginal placentation. For example, we have to cut the ovary in this direction, means longitudinal direction. For example, it is ovary, it is style and stigma. Okay, here in this type, the ovules are attached on the one side of the ovary on a ridge like structure. Okay, there will be a beading or a ridge like structure on one side of ovary. On that ridge, we can see ovules are attached in one row like this. In all Fabids or Fabaceae members, we can see this type of placentation. Okay, that is marginal placentation. We can see one ovule in the transfer section like this. Okay, whenever we take a section in the transverse manner, we can see one ovule in the transverse slice. Okay, this is about marginal placentation. Next one is basal placentation. Here also we have to cut the ovary in the transverse manner only. Here in the basal placentation, we can see one ovule from the base like this. Okay, this is ovule. Okay, like this, the ovules are arranged at the base. That's why it is called basal placentation. This is second type. The third one is apical placentation. Here, the ovule born from the top, it appear like hanging down. Okay, like this. The ovule is attached at the apex. That's why it is called apical placentation. Okay. Now we will see parietal, free central and axial also. In the parietal placentation, we have to cut the ovary in transverse manner. In the parietal placentation, we can see ovules attached on the placenta, which distributed all over the inner surface. Okay, here there is one placenta, here also one placenta, here also one placenta. Okay, the ovules are attached on this placenta like this, here, here also like this. We can see parietal placentation, means they are arranged on placenta. The placenta are placed on throughout the inner surface. Okay, this is about parietal placentation. Coming to the free central placentation, here also we can better understand this placentation type with the help of longitudinal section only. For example, this is longitudinal section of ovary. Here in the axial placentation, you can see one central axis or axil. On this axil, we can see ovules are attached like this without any physical contact with the this ovary wall. Okay, they are freely arranged on the central axis. That's why it is called as free central placentation. Okay, free central placentation. They are attached on the central axis without any physical contact with this ovary wall. Okay, this is about free central. Coming to the axial placentation, it is very similar to the free central placentation only, but here the difference is the septa formation. Okay, here the septa is formed. For example, this is central axis. Okay, this is also central axis, this is also central axis, but here on the central axis the ovules are originating in both cases, but here we can see septa or locule formation in the axial placentation, but here there is no septa. For example, whenever we take a section of free central placentation, you can see the ovules are arranged on this central axis only like this, but there is no septa in case of free central placentation. But here we can see septa, means locule formation in the axial placentation. Here also attached to the central axis only, but here only difference is septa formation. Here there is no septa formation. Okay, otherwise both are similar. Okay, this is all about different placentation types. Okay, now I will give one example for each. Now we will see the examples for this placentation. Okay, the marginal placentation we can see in beans and pea plants. Okay, for example, in beans and pea plants we can see marginal placentation. Okay, the parietal placentation we can see in mustard plants, mustard fruits. Okay, in the mustard fruits we can see parietal placentation. The axial placentation we can see in lemon. Okay, lemon, citrus. Okay, in the lemon fruit we can see axial placentation. The basal placentation we can see in marigold, marigold, or and also in tridax we can see the basal placentation. The free central placentation we can see in primrose. Okay, in the primrose we can see free central placentation. Okay, this is all about placentation types. Every time they are asking one placentation type for 2 marks. That's why you should concentrate on this placentation types. Okay, next, based on the position of ovary, we have 3 types of flowers or ovary types that we already discussed in the first video. Again I will discuss here. Okay, types of ovary based on the position, okay, where it is located. Based on that we have 3 types of ovaries. One is hypogynous flowers, perigynous flowers, epigynous flowers. Based on the position of ovary we have 3 types of flowers. అంటే హైపోగైనస్, పెరిగైనస్, ఎపిగైనస్. మీన్స్ హియర్ ద త్రీ ఓరల్స్, ద లోయర్ త్రీ ఓరల్స్ డిసైడ్ ద పొజిషన్ ఆఫ్ ద ఫోర్త్ ఓరల్, దట్ ఈస్ గైనీషియన్. హియర్ ద ఓవరీ డూ నాట్ డూ ఎనీథింగ్. ఓకే, బేస్డ్ ఆన్ దీస్ త్రీ లోయర్ ఓరల్ ఆరిజిన్ పాయింట్ ద గైనీషియం పొజిషన్ ఈస్ డిసైడింగ్. దట్ ఈస్ వెరీ ఇంపార్టెంట్. ఓకే, హౌ ద పొజిషన్ ఈస్ డిసైడింగ్ దట్ వీ విల్ సీ విత్ సింపుల్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్స్. ఫర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్, నౌ వీ విల్ సీ హైపోగైనస్ ఫ్లవర్స్. ఓకే, ఇన్ ద హైపోగైనస్ ఫ్లవర్స్ ఇట్ ఈస్ థలామస్, ఇట్ ఈస్ గైనీషియం స్టైల్ అండ్ స్టిగ్మా. ఓకే, ద లోయర్ త్రీ ఓరల్స్ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద లోయర్ పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ గైనీషియం ఆర్ ఓవరీ. ఓకే, హియర్ దీస్ త్రీ ఓరల్స్, 1, 2, 3, త్రీ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద బేస్ ఆఫ్ గైనీషియం. మీన్స్ హైపో గైనస్, హైపో మీన్స్ లోయర్, లోయర్ సైడ్, ఎపి మీన్స్ అప్పర్ సైడ్. హియర్ ద ఫస్ట్ అండ్ సెకండ్ అండ్ థర్డ్ ఓరల్స్ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద బేస్ ఆఫ్ గైనీషియం. దట్స్ వై బేస్ అదర్వైజ్ నోన్ యాజ్ హైపో. హైపో మీన్స్ లోయర్ సైడ్, ఎపి మీన్స్ అప్పర్ సైడ్. సిన్స్ ఆల్ ఫస్ట్ అండ్ సెకండ్ అండ్ థర్డ్ ఓరల్స్ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద బేస్ ఆఫ్ గైనీషియం, ద ఫ్లవర్స్ ఆర్ నోన్ యాజ్ హైపోగైనస్ ఫ్లవర్స్. కమింగ్ టు ద సెకండ్ టైప్, హియర్ ద ఓవరీ ఈజ్ హాఫ్ సబ్మెర్జ్డ్ అండ్ హాఫ్ విజిబుల్. ఓకే, హాఫ్ ఆఫ్ ద ఓవరీ ఈజ్ సంకెన్ ఇన్ ఏ కప్ లైక్ స్ట్రక్చర్ ఆర్ ఇన్ ఏ థలామస్ టిష్యూ. ఓన్లీ హాఫ్ ఆఫ్ ద ఓవరీ ఈజ్ విజిబుల్ టు ద అవుట్ సైడ్. ఫ్రమ్ దీస్ పాయింట్ మీన్స్ ఫ్రమ్ ద హాఫ్ ఆఫ్ ద ఓవరీ హైట్ ద అదర్ త్రీ ఓరల్స్ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్, క్యాలిక్స్, కొరోల్లా అండ్ ఆండ్రిషియం. దట్స్ వై దిస్ టైప్ ఈజ్ నోన్ యాజ్ పెరిగైనస్, మీన్స్ ద అదర్ త్రీ ఓరల్స్ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద పెరిఫెరల్ ఆఫ్ ద ఓవరీ. దట్స్ వై ఇట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ యాజ్ పెరిగైనస్. అదర్వైజ్ కాల్డ్ హాఫ్ ఇన్ఫీరియర్, హాఫ్ సుపీరియర్ ఆల్సో ఇట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్. ఓకే, ఇట్ ఈస్ నోన్ యాజ్ హాఫ్ సుపీరియర్ ఆర్ హాఫ్ ఇన్ఫీరియర్. ఓకే, కమింగ్ టు ద థర్డ్ టైప్, హియర్ ద గైనీషియం ఈజ్ టోటలీ సబ్మెర్జ్డ్ ఆర్ టోటలీ సంకెన్ ఇన్ ద థలామస్ టిష్యూ. ఓకే, హియర్ ద ఓవరీ ఈజ్ కంప్లీట్లీ ఎన్వలప్డ్ బై థలామస్ టిష్యూ. దెర్ ఇస్ నో ఓవరీ విజిబిలిటీ టు ద అవుట్ సైడ్. ఓన్లీ స్టైల్ అండ్ స్టిగ్మా ఈజ్ అపియరింగ్. ఓకే, రిమైనింగ్ ఆల్ ఎంటైర్ గైనీషియం పోర్షన్ ఈజ్ సబ్మెర్జ్డ్ ఇన్ ద థలామస్ టిష్యూ. ద అదర్ త్రీ ఓరల్స్ దే ఆర్ ద ఫస్ట్ అండ్ సెకండ్ అండ్ థర్డ్ ఓరల్స్ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద టాప్ ఆఫ్ ద ఓవరీ. దట్స్ వై ఇట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ యాజ్ ఎపిగైనస్. దీస్ త్రీ ఓరల్స్ ఫస్ట్ అండ్ సెకండ్ అండ్ థర్డ్ ఓరల్స్ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద టాప్ ఆఫ్ ద ఓవరీ. దట్స్ వై ఇట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ ఎపి. ఎపి మీన్స్ అపాన్. ఓకే, ఇన్ దిస్ టైప్ ద అదర్ త్రీ ఓరల్స్ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద టాప్ ఆఫ్ ద ఓవరీ. దట్స్ వై దిస్ ఇస్ కాల్డ్ యాజ్ ఎపిగైనస్ టైప్ ఆఫ్ ఫ్లవర్. అండ్ వన్ మోర్ థింగ్, హియర్ వీ హ్యావ్ టు అండర్స్టాండ్ దట్ వెన్ ఎవర్ ఆల్ త్రీ పార్ట్స్ ఆర్ ఆరిజినేటింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద బేస్ ఆఫ్ గైనీషియం, ఆటోమేటికలీ ద గైనీషియం పొజిషన్ విల్ బి సుపీరియర్. దట్స్ వై హైపోగైనస్ ఫ్లవర్స్ కన్సిస్ట్ సుపీరియర్ ఓవరీస్, సుపీరియర్ ఓవరీస్. ఎపిగైనస్ ఫ్లవర్స్ కన్సిస్ట్ ఇన్ఫీరియర్ ఓవరీస్. దిస్ ఇస్ వెరీ ఇంపార్టెంట్. ఇన్ ద ఎగ్జామినేషన్ యూ మే ఆస్క్ లైక్ వాట్ ఈస్ ఎపిగైనస్, వాట్ ఈస్ హైపోగైనస్, వాట్ ఈస్ పెరిగైనస్. ఓకే, వాట్ ఈస్ యాక్సిల్ ప్రజెంటేషన్, వాట్ ఈస్ ఫ్రీ సెంట్రల్ ప్రజెంటేషన్, వాట్ ఈస్ పెరటల్ ప్రజెంటేషన్, మార్జినల్ ప్రజెంటేషన్, బేసల్ ప్రజెంటేషన్, అపికల్ ప్రజెంటేషన్, లైక్ దిస్ దే మే ఆస్క్ యూ. ఓకే, ఫర్ 2 marks, దిస్ ఆర్ ఆల్ వెరీ ఇంపార్టెంట్ టాపిక్స్. అండ్ నౌ వీ విల్ సీ వన్ మోర్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ టర్మ్ రిలేటెడ్ టు గైనీషియం ఆర్ ఓవరీ, దట్ ఈస్ కార్పెల్. కార్పెల్ ఇట్ ఈస్ నథింగ్ బట్ ఎ సబ్యూనిట్ ఆఫ్ ఓవరీ. ఎ సబ్యూనిట్ ఆఫ్ ఓవరీ మీన్స్ ఇట్ ఈస్
a portion in the ovary. The number of carpels may be different. It may be 1 or 2 or 3 or 4, 5 or more. Means whenever we take a section of ovary, we can see many partitions in the anatomy like this. Okay, this each partition is known as carpel. Carpel. Based on the number of carpels in the ovary, we can named as unicarpellary, bicarpellary, tricarpellary, tetracarpellary, pentacarpellary and multicarpellary ovaries. Based on the number of carpel it consists, the ovaries are called as unicarpellary, bicarpellary, tetracarpellary, pentacarpellary, multicarpellary. Means whenever we cut an ovary, we can see only one locule inside. It means it is unicarpellary. Whenever we cut an ovary, we can see two partitions. One, two. This is bicarpellary ovary. The same way, in some ovaries, we can see three partitions. In some, there will be four partitions. In some, five. In some ovaries, we can see multicarpellary conditions. Okay? Here, one more thing. These carpels either apocarpus or syncarpus. What is apocarpus? Apocarpus means unfused condition. Unfused condition means, for example, on thalamus, usually you can see ovaries like this. Okay? This is ovary, this is style, this is stigma. In the ovary, we can see number of carpels or partitions. Whenever we see the anatomy, we can see this type of partitions. These partitions are called carpels. All carpels covered by a common envelope, that is ovary wall. Okay? This condition is known as syncarpous ovary. Whenever the number of carpel is more, but it is surrounded by a common ovary wall, that condition is known as syncarpous ovary condition or syncarpous ovaries. But in some conditions, on thalamus, the carpels are placed distantly. The carpels are placed distantly. Means like this. The carpels are unfused to each other. This condition is known as apocarpus. Okay? These ovaries are called apocarpus ovaries. Okay? Like this, we have carpel or carpels in the gynecium. Based on the number of carpel it consists, we can call them as unicarpellary, bicarpellary, tricarpellary, tetracarpellary, penta or multicarpellary. Okay? The condition is like this. Okay? The each carpel having one septa usually. In some condition, even the septa also absent. For example, here in the parietal placentation, here there is no distinct zonation, means distinct septa between carpels. But here it is not unilocular or unicarpellary ovary. It is tricarpellary ovary. Okay? How can we say? Means we can say Based on the number of placenta also, we can identify the number of carpels. Means here, for example, 1, 2, 3. There are 3 placenta. That's why it is called as tricarpellary ovary, though it is not having any distinct septa. Okay. Here, there is a septa. That's why you can easily say that it is one carpel, it is one carpel. It is one carpel, second one, third one, like this. Okay. Next, based on one more criteria, that is whether they are fused or not. Based on, we have two more types of ovaries. They are apocarpus, syncarpus. In the apocarpus ovaries, on thalamus, all carpels are placed distantly, not fused to each other. Means here, there is no common wall around carpels. That's why they are distantly placed. The best example is Nilambo and Nymphaea. We can see apocarpus condition in Nilambo and Nymphaea flowers. The syncarpus, it is common type of ovary found in almost all angiosperms. Like for example, Solanum, Melangina, Lycopersicon, Tomato and Brinjal. In all these plants, we can see syncarpus condition. Okay, this is all about carpels. Next, we will discuss one more thing here itself. Here, we know that the ovules are attached to the inner surface of ovary. Okay, inner surface of ovary with the help of a stalk-like structure called funicle. Where it is attached? It is attached to the placenta. Placenta means it is a place where the ovules are attached. Okay, based on the placenta, we have different types of placentation types. They are discussed already. But here, we have to understand how these ovules are originating or how they born from the ovary wall. That we will see now. Okay, for that, we have to take a section of ovary. Okay, it is longitudinal section of ovary. The ovary wall consists many layers of parenchymatous tissue. The cells are arranged in rows like this. Here we are discussing about how the ovules are arise from the ovary wall. It's very simple that we will see with this simple diagram. Okay, here we have many layers of cells, right? At the initial step of ovule formation, either second layer of cells or third layer of cells, okay, take an initiation to the birth of ovule. Okay, it may be initiating from the second line of cells or third line of cells. Okay, from these two line of cells, the ovule will be started to grow. Okay, first of all, either from the second line of cell or third line of cell. Okay, one cell will become de-differentiated. Okay, will become de-differentiated. For example, sometimes the ovule is arise from the second layer of cells. That ovule formation is known as digonate ovule formation. Digonate ovule or digonate ovule formation. Suppose if they originating from the third layer of cells, that ovules are called trigonate ovules. Okay, either the ovules are originating from the second layer of cells called digonate ovules or from the third layer of cells called trigonate ovules. Okay? And one more thing, trigonate ovules are considered as primitive type of ovules. Digonate ovules are considered as advanced type of ovules. Okay? The trigonate ovules are primitive type when compared with digonate ovules. For example, in Euphorbiaceae, we can see this type of ovule formation in Euphorbiaceae and Amaryllidaceae. In Euphorbiaceae and Amaryllidaceae families, these two are families. In these families, usually we can see trigonate type of ovule formation. And in Begoniaceae, it is also one family type. We can see digonate type of ovule formation. Here, the only important thing is from where the ovule is arising. From the second layer of cells or third layer of cells. These two are very important. Okay. And next, after de-differentiation of these cells, either from second layer of cells or third layer of cells, whatever it may be, the first step, they started to divide mitotically. They started to divide mitotically, the two, in a periclinal manner. Periclinal manner. Okay? They mitotically divide in a periclinal manner so that they just produce a mass of tissue like this. Okay? The mass of tissue like this. After that, finally, they produce entire ovule like this. This formation or this cell differentiation is very similar to the tunica corpus theory. Means whatever statement given by Smidit in the tunica corpus theory, the same statement or the same procedure is following in this ovule formation. Okay, this is all about ovule initiation. Okay, this is all about structure of pistil or gynecium and types of placentation and types of flowers and types of ovule initiation. Okay, in the next video we will discuss about structure of an ovule. After that we will see different types of ovules. Okay, thank you.